Hello guys, welcome to Physics Grad. In this video, we are going to look at motion of systems in one dimension. Okay, so what do we mean when we say motion is in one dimension? So the meaning of this is as follows. Okay, so motion of a system with 1 degree of freedom. Okay, this takes place in one dimension. 1 degree of freedom takes place in one dimension. Okay, so when do we say motion is in one dimension? When the number of degrees of freedom is equal to 1. So if the number of degrees of freedom is equal to 1, this implies number of independent coordinates needed to represent this motion is equal to 1, and I'm going to call this as Q in terms of the generalized coordinates. Then we have seen in our previous lectures that in general our kinetic energy term is given by half summation over I some function of vector q, where q is basically q1, q2, ... qs, where s is the number of degrees of freedom, qj dot. Okay, this is the general form of the kinetic energy. But when we have s is equal to 1, this will simply become half a of q dot squared. Okay, so our Lagrangian will have the form for 1 degree of freedom, will have the form half a of q. So in this case our q is just going to be the variable q, not q vector, only 1 q, into q dot squared minus the potential function, which depends only on the coordinates. Alright, so in terms of Cartesian coordinates, motion in one dimension can be represented as follows. In Cartesian coordinates, L will become half mx dot square minus u of x. Correct? Alright, now to know how the particle moves, we need to know x of t. Right, and if we know x of t, we can differentiate it with respect to time and find x dot of t and so on. Now in the case of one dimension, okay, we need not in fact solve for equation of motion to get x of t. We can simply use the conservation of energy in order to get x of t, and that is got as follows. Okay, so to get x of t in this case we don't need to solve for Euler Lagrange equations. Okay, because we know that the total energy is going to be t plus u, which is half mx dot square plus u of x, and for a closed system, since dou L by dou t is equal to 0, implies E is constant. We have already seen this in our previous lectures. So we can write x dot as equal to E minus u of x power half into root of 2 by m. I'm just rewriting this same equation, but I'm finding just x dot in terms of all the other quantities. Now this implies x dot by, or in other words, this x dot is equal to dx by dt. So we will have dx divided by root e minus u of x, correct? This into root m by 2 is equal to dt. So integrating both sides, what we will get? We will get root m by 2 integral dx by root e minus u of x is equal to t plus some integration constant c. Okay, now to solve this integral we need to know what is the form of u of x. Once we know that, we can integrate this equation and get, so from here we can get x of t implies we know how the system moves. Okay, so to proceed further we need to know the form of u of x. Now we already know that if we had solved our Euler-Lagrange equations, we would get 2s arbitrary constants, and in this case s is equal to 1 implies 2s is equal to 2 constant. Even in this equation, if you notice, there are two constants. One is the constant due to integration and the other one is our energy. So even here we have E and C, and the value of these two constants depend on the initial condition, correct? All right, so before we move further, we have to note that our kinetic energy is always greater than or equal to zero because it is square of some number, which is always positive, square of a real number, and mass is also always positive. So our kinetic energy is going to be always greater than or equal to zero. This implies our total energy E is T plus U, which means U is equal to E minus T. And using this inequality, it directly follows that U is always less than or equal to E, because this particular quantity is always less than E, unless T is 0, in which case it will be equal to E. Alright? So therefore, our potential energy is going to be always less than or equal to the total energy, and hence the motion can take place. Okay, so therefore motion can take place only in those regions of space where u of x is less than e. Alright, so what do we mean by this? Let us take an example. So let us say that our u of x, this is x, has some form which looks like this. Okay, this continues like this, and let us say that our total energy lies somewhere over here. This is a constant, it's an arbitrary constant depending on our initial conditions. Okay, so let us name these points as A, B and C. Now since u of x is always less than or equal to e, our motion is going to happen only in those regions where u of x is less than e, and that those regions are basically these. So let me use a different color. So these regions, this is one and this is the other. Okay, so if you notice here, so this means that the particle cannot move in these regions. okay, the particle never comes to this region if its total energy is given by E, and it can only move in the region marked by green. Okay, so let us say that this is x1, this is x2, this is x3. Okay, so if you notice, if the particle initially lies between x1 and x2, it will always remain in this region. Okay, whereas if it lies beyond x3, it can go to infinity. Okay, because this particular curve can go until infinity, and in all of those regions u of x is less than e. Okay, so what do we have here? So therefore, points where u of x is equal to e implies t is equal to 0, which implies v is equal to 0. So the object is going to stop there, and if it wants, it can go back to the other regions, to the same region, but in the opposite direction. So these points are called the turning points. So turning points. Okay. Therefore, if a region is bounded by two such points, which is our case in this part, this region. Okay, this is bounded by A and B. So if it is bounded by two such points, this implies that motion takes place in a finite region. Okay, else particle can go to infinity, which is our case, which is the case in this region. Okay, I think that is clear now. One more thing that you can notice here is that when motion is finite in 1D, it is oscillatory for a closed system. Okay, so why is it oscillatory? So what I'm claiming here is that if our motion happens in this region, okay, then the claim is that the particle is always going to oscillate in this manner. Okay, so it goes back and forth from x1 to x2 and x2 to x1 and so on. But why should that happen? Okay, so the reason is the following. So let me write some statements down and explain it to you. The particle moves repeatedly back and forth, and this is the meaning of oscillatory motion. This is periodic. Okay, this is periodic because when the particle comes back to the initial point, okay, to the initial point. All the conditions remain exactly the same as it was when it started. So what I mean by this, okay, so if you see here, let us say that the particle started at this point. Okay, let us say the particle starts at this point. Then at this point, this particle feels a force given by minus dou u by dou x. And in this case, the force is going to be positive, which means its direction is going to be like this, because this slope is negative and negative times negative gives a direction in the positive direction. So the particle is going to move in this manner. It is going to move that way. But when it reaches this point, when it reaches B, its velocity becomes zero and the slope is positive here. So the force will be in this direction and therefore the particle starts moving back. Okay. And again, it reaches this point, but now it has some velocity in some direction. Let us say that initially the velocity was in this direction. Then now the velocity will be in this direction due to inertia, and it starts moving again till point A, where it comes to rest, and there also it feels a force in the positive direction and again comes back to the original point. Now once it is in this original point, if you compare this instant with the instant when it just started, it has no way of differentiating whether it is just starting now again or whether it has already covered one whole back and forth motion. Okay, which means it will repeat the motion exactly as it did when it began the motion. Okay, and that is what I mean by this statement. Okay, so this implies it should follow exactly same motion again, right? Okay, so once we have established that, this is going to be periodic because the motion is going to repeat itself in the same manner. Okay, then how do we find the period T? Okay, so how to find period, which I'm going to denote it as T. Okay, this period T of E is going to be, let us say that to make it simpler, it is starting from x1 and goes to x2 and again comes back to x1. Okay, then our period T, we have already seen that our equation of motion as, or when we integrate this particular equation, we get our expression for T. Okay, so this T is basically the time taken for the particle to move from some particular point to another particular point. In our case, we want to find the time taken to complete one oscillation, which means this will be equal to twice the time taken to go from x1 to x2. Okay, because the time it takes for it to go from x1 to x2 is going to be exactly same as it takes to go from x2 to x1, because the motion is reversible. Okay, time reversible, because the Lagrangian is independent of time. Okay, which this part, that is time reversibility, we have already seen in one of our previous lecture, So this is going to be root of m by 2, right? So we are basically writing the same equation. So root of m by 2 times dx by root e minus u of x, right? So this will give us the time period where x1 and x2 is equal to roots of equation e equal to u of x. And that is what here also the x1 corresponds to the point of intersection of e and u of x, wherein e becomes equal to u of x. Okay. Alright. So therefore, we get t as a function of total energy, because when we apply the limits of integration, all the x in this equation will go. What we are left with is this energy. So if we vary the energy, the time period will also might also vary, okay, depending on what this integral is. All right so I hope you have understood this. And that's it for this video. See you next time.